Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Nepal Institute for International Cooperation and Engagement, I welcome all of you to the International Young Scholars Summit 2020. I extend a very warm welcome to our distinguished chair for the session, Ambassador Vishnu Prakash, fellow scholars and participants who have joined us through Zoom and are watching us live on our YouTube channel. We're glad to witness your presence today. This international forum aims to bring together rigorous and erudite young scholars from all around the world over a single platform. The aim is to create an academic space to encourage young scholars and academicians from the field of international relations, political science, diplomacy, public policy, administration, and related subfields. The conference will be held for 3 days consecutively and will have 30 different sessions, with 2 sessions running parallelly throughout in white and green rooms. The conference will feature 275 scholars from 25 different countries who will be delivering their presentations and sharing their understanding on various topics with us. The session is streaming live on our YouTube channel, so please feel free to share it on your social media handles with the hashtag IYSS2020. This is the 3rd day of the conference and 24th session. To chair and moderate this session, it's a real pleasure to have with us Ambassador Vishnu Prakash sir with us. Ambassador Vishnu Prakash has served as High Commissioner to Ottawa, Ambassador to Seoul, Official Spokesperson at Foreign Office and Consul General to Shanghai. He has also done postings in Moscow, New York, Tokyo, Islamabad, etc. Since retirement in November 2016, he has turned into a foreign affairs analyst and commentator with a special focus on Indo-Pacific region. Sir, it's a pleasure to have you here. Without any further ado, I'd like to request you to please take the session forward. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Am I audible? Yeah. Thank you, Pakhi. I mean, you have very gently told everybody my age, so I really appreciate that. Dr. Pramod Jaiswal, fellow panelists, friends. Good morning, namaste, and welcome. I am delighted that we are together to discuss a subject which is very important for any country, but particularly important for India at this stage, because we are in the throes of a reset of India's foreign policy. How deep would be the reset, in what areas would it be so, remains to be seen. We have always liked to say that India's foreign policy represents continuity with change, which is true, but of late, I think the pace of change is gathering pace, and particularly so after the end of the Cold War. Disintegration of the Soviet Union was dealt a heavy blow to India's geopolitical assumptions. Over the succeeding 3 decades, we diversified and deepened partnerships with key global players. And a section of analysts believe today that as things stand, the world is still unipolar militarily. There is a rising power, but the hegemon which is calling the shots, I think, is far ahead in its military might as compared to a rising power. But when it comes to the economic side, I think we are still a multipolar world. Although the question that is arising slowly is, will we see an Asian century or will it become a Chinese century? India, let's be frank, has gradually moved away from non-alignment to multi-alignment. And now there is question of whether we will see multi-alignment plus. I will touch upon that. We are presently confronted with a black swan event, which we all feared but hoped will not happen. It has wreaked damage and disruption of an untold proportion to the economic, political, and strategic world order. And then there is, given the dynamics, especially the security dynamics in India's neighborhood, how will India's foreign policy unfold? Can there be issue-based alignments or even alliances? India will have to make some critical choices. I think the time when we had the luxury of neutrality is more or less over. But everything will hinge on security. I think security has become a very important concern for India's foreign policy. And when it comes to the neighborhood also, it will be a touchstone in development of relations with the neighborhood. So with these brief opening remarks, let me set the ball rolling. We have exactly 85 minutes. We have 8 listed speakers. And we have been requested to have 30 minutes of Q&A. So we have 55 minutes or less. So as I wrote to all of you, I propose to be disciplined, although I must say that I started my career in the Soviet Union, where the shortest speech was 2 hours. But I've since learned that if I speak for 2 hours, there'll be consequences and collateral and unintended damage. So I'll be very disciplined, and I seek your indulgence to be so. I'll give you all a 5-minute prompt out of 6 minutes. When it's 5, I'll prompt you. And can I request you that even if you're in mid-sentence, when it's a 6-minute, please stop to accommodate others. So with this and without any further ado, can I invite Dr. Swati Rao to make her presentation? Swasti, go ahead, please.
Yes. Yeah. Good afternoon, sir. Yes, this is Swasti. And like you said, you know, you've already set the clock to 5 minutes. So without any more introduction and niceties, but I would definitely like to thank, you know, Pramod for inviting us over and over again. And it is something we look forward to. My paper is on multilateralism in COVID times, smart power approach to ambivalent geopolitics. Bad news is that I have to really be very precise, but the good news is that this commentary is already published by NICE. So those of you who are interested in reading the full paper, it is already available. Right now, I will just begin by saying that my paper is divided largely into 3 parts, where in the first part, I first outline what I mean by ambivalent geopolitics. And I kind of, you know, note it down into about 8 points. Then in the next part, I discuss about why are the multilateral organizations like the WHO and G20 important? And India is coming up with the G20 presidency in 2022. So how is that going to affect the current politics of India? And the third part is the part that I would like to discuss in detail today in my 5 minutes, which is that what really are the challenges before India that it needs to tackle before it delivers well on such multilateral platforms. So, of course, coming straight to the point, I say the G20 is especially important for countries like India because it provides a developing country, populous country, with an opportunity to display its global, political, economic, and intellectual leadership on the same platform with the world's most important countries. And as to why G20 is important, there is a lot of literature already, and I've also highlighted it in my paper. But for delivering on the multilateral promise, India has to tackle 5 main challenges. The first of that group is the economic challenges, like we all know, and I'm going to discuss that. Because as trade tensions escalate among major powers and global growth deaccelerates, the G20 countries will find it very hard to present a common framework to tackle global challenges. Ensuring a smooth ride back to normalcy for economies marred by the lockdown hibernation will be tough to nail and necessitates that India caters to its own economic woes first. So it will be expected of India to develop coordinated action in line with the extraordinary summit, where an unflinching commitment to address the issue of debt vulnerability made the policy of debt freeze possible, alongside the International Monetary Fund setting up a catastrophe containment and relief trust for the same. So the challenge which is facing India is twofold. One, of taking on the massive task mentioned above, and two, recovering its own economy. So the first point then is that there is an immediate need of additional stimulus packages, because despite the nationalistic rhetoric, according to Moody's, the Indian economy is likely to be in a freeze this year, and we are seeing it, with recovery picking up only by the end of 2020, given that additional stimulus packages are announced. The government's 1.7 lakh crore stimulus package has been called modest compared with support packages implemented in many other countries, particularly given the breadth of India's nationwide lockdown measures. However, better news is that they also predict that the Indian economy is likely to bounce back at a 2 to 2.5% next year and 6% in fiscal year 2022 if the necessary measures are taken. Related with this is the role of the Reserve Bank of India, because there has been criticism regarding RBI's decision to not cut down interest rates to boost the economy when most professional forecasters expect the Indian economy to contract between a 5 to a 6% in the current financial year. Further, there's compelling evidence that the RBI may continue to not cut interest rates even in October. However, this might also check retail inflation if and only if RBI also makes the banks reduce their lending interest rates to people commensurably enough. In other words, the onus of reviving the manufacturing sector and through it employment and the national economy at large lies solely in the hands of the central leadership. The decisions they take now are going to significantly impact the outcomes of financial year 2021 and 2022, when India will be hosting the G20 in New Delhi. Again, another related economic measure is the deferment of the Basel III norms and averting a banking crisis, because RBI, in view of the coronavirus pandemic, deferred the implementation of Basel III norms for banking services by a year. So earlier they were scheduled to come into effect from January 22, and now they are deferred by a year. So they will come into effect from January 23. Now this would provide a breathing space and additional operational capacity for banks to respond to the immediate financial stability priorities. But India has to make sure that this deferment does not trigger a brewing banking crisis in the absence of regulative norms, which are already adopted by major economies of the G20, including China. The last two points were to do with interdisciplinary intellectual dynamism and freedom of expression that is curtailed in India for now. A lot of intellectuals would complain of it. And lastly, I would say that India needs to protect its fast eroding democratic institutions and check populism and eroding of democratic institutions, because it is India must put its house in order first, because it's the people from where a nation really draws its real fuel from. For a detailed discussion, I am looking forward to the question answer session. Thank you so much.
You are simply amazing. You have 5 seconds in your bank account you can use whenever you want to. I have two questions for you, and you have princely 30 seconds to respond to them. One, is India ready for the G20?
Yes.
Post it. And two, when you said the economy can start the growth trajectory again if necessary measures are taken.
Yes, sir.
What necessary measures?
So first, whether India is prepared for G20, my answer is right now, definitely not. But we have about a 2-year window to prepare for it. And that is the entire discourse, that if you take the necessary measures now and kind of, want to stick to your commitment to multilateralism, you have about a year and a half to kind of put it into order. But right now, I don't think India is right away, prepared. The second answer, what are the important measures? The first definitely would be, a stimulus package, because until the stimulus package is put into the, this is what we are seeing everywhere, whether it's Japan or the rest of the world. If the economy is in freeze, then the government needs to kind of kickstart it, because the people cannot do it on their own, because of the fear psychosis and everything. So the additional stimulus package is a must. So what the government has done, at least thrice that time until they commit something of the same effect, the economy will be in a very bad shape. And that was what...
We'll come back to that, whether we can afford it.
True.
Shivani, the floor is yours. 5 minutes.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you in between. I have received a message from a speaker stating that she wouldn't be able to speak too fast because we had mentioned in the schedule that 8 minutes will be given to deliver their presentations. So can we do something regarding the same?
No, I have sent a mail out to everybody. 6 minutes is written in stone. So Shivani, go ahead, please.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Firstly, I would like to thank Dr. Pramod and the NICE Institute for giving me an opportunity to participate in this wonderful conference. The topic that I've chosen for today's presentation is India's nuclear behavior changing? With the kind of border tensions that we have witnessed over the past 4 or 5 years on our western and eastern front with Pakistan and China, the topic of nuclear war, politics and nuclear deterrence has been hotly debated, especially in the context of the South Asian subcontinent. Many analysts have proclaimed that India, China and Pakistan may well be heading towards a nuclear Armageddon. And this begs some very crucial questions that need to be delved upon more. Is there an increasing possibility of a nuclear standoff between India and its neighbors? Has this possibility increased many folds under the current dispensation, that is the BJP and the Modi government? And most importantly, can one decipher a clear and tangible change in India's nuclear behavior, in other words, nuclear culture, from say 5 decades back to the last 2 decades? So in my presentation, I try to tackle these very questions, and I would just like to state that this is an extraction from my MPhil dissertation, so any feedback is much welcome. When talking about strategic culture, it is important to understand what do we exactly mean by strategic nuclear culture. Many scholars have tried to define this term. The most popular definition that was given by Jack Snyder says that the strategic culture is sum total of ideas, conditioned emotional responses, patterns of habitual behavior that members of a national strategic community have acquired through instruction and imitation. And over time, this particular term of strategic culture has also come to include conceptions of shared beliefs and collective identities. So then how does one go on to quantify and assess a state's nuclear behavior? There are essentially three broad types of nuclear behavior, nuclear cultures that we can identify. The first one is accommodationist nuclear culture, which entails patterns of accommodative patterns exhibited over a period of time by a state in response to external or internal threat, which would include economic, diplomatic, or political tools. And these are chosen over, say, a nuclear option or a nuclear use in case of states which already have nuclear capability. The second kind of nuclear behavior, nuclear culture, is defensive nuclear culture, which comprises of limited use, restrained nuclear behavior with a minimalist nuclear posture, something that is manifested in, say, a no first use kind of posture that India and China have. The third kind of broad nuclear culture that can be identified is offensive or expansionist nuclear culture, which is at the extreme end of the spectrum, which includes a possible use of nuclear weapons, which forms a very decisive part of a state security strategy. And this includes a nuclear capability that is specially targeted at flexible and tailored nuclear deterrence by opting for low-yield nuclear weaponization and effective time-saving delivery vehicles. Against these, there are 5 main objects of analysis which we can measure to understand what kind of nuclear culture a particular state has adhered to or is adhering to. These 5 objects of analysis that I have identified are ethical norms associated with nuclear weapons, historical context, change in technological capability and free and open accessibility to nuclear material, availability of economic resources, and external threat perceptions. In order to understand whether the nuclear culture in India has changed or not over the past 2 decades, it is important to understand what kind of nuclear culture has existed in the past. So from the period of 1947 to 1998, how does one prioritize or see these 5 objects of analysis on the preference ranking scale? And in my research and findings, I have come to the conclusion that from 47 to 98, the emphasis was primarily on economic considerations. With widespread hunger and poverty and a balance of payment crisis, the leaders had to make a very tough decision between prioritizing economic and developmental needs over building a credible nuclear deterrent. This is also the reason why India has had a very unsteady path towards full nuclearization and why it took almost 24 long years after its first nuclear test in 1974 to fully declare itself as a full-fledged nuclear weapon state. And the hiccups that one sees in India's nuclear journey towards full nuclearization is because of the priority preference that was given to economic considerations back then. The second most influencing factor in that period has been moral imperative, that is the norms attached to non-violence and taboo against use of force. The third determinant on the preference list is the lack of appropriate technology and capability and access to nuclear technology and nuclear know-how. The fourth preference has been on identity assertion narratives, and the fifth one has been on external security threat. Compared to that, if one had to broadly categorize the nuclear culture from 47 to 98, we can say that it was accommodationist in nature. Whereas in comparison to that, from 1998 to 2019, over the past two decades, the culture has moved more from accommodationist to accommodationist defensive nuclear culture. I wish I had more time to explain this, but I'm sure this will come up in the discussions in the Q&A in the future. So thank you.
Bravo, you did it. You know, I have been a former diplomat for 36 years, and all I can tell you is that what can be said in 2 hours can be said in 5 minutes. So it's just a discussion. Now, compliments, you have taken your sweep or the canvas has been very, very broad, and you have tried to encapsulate so much in your paper, glimpses of which you gave in your remarks. I'm afraid I disagree with your analysis to a large extent, because as I see it, you have a Western orientation and you're looking at it through the Western prism, as I see it. I would aver that it was not so much economic, because when it comes to national security, you don't look at economic matters so much. You should bite the bullet, you bite the bullet. But it was a conviction that nuclear weapons will lead to the, if everybody has nuclear weapons, it will only cause complications, it will not help. And second was security. So we kept on postponing it, but we were ready. And then we had to bite the bullet, because we are literally, our security was getting compromised. That is my take. But just 30 seconds, if you can, you opened by saying that the chances of a nuclear Armageddon is very high. It's a very strong statement. How do you come to that conclusion? 30 seconds.
Actually, so what I implied was that many analysts are claiming that India, China, and Pakistan may well be heading towards that path. But in my presentation,
your viewpoint, no. So I mean,
it's not my viewpoint. I was stating the general rhetoric and the kind of narrative that is going on out there. But my presentation is contrary to that. I don't support that claim. I don't think
you don't.
No.
All right. Thank you. Is Dr. Alok Kumar there?
No, sir. He wouldn't be present. He has certain technical issues at his end.
But he will not be joining us.
No, sir. He wouldn't be joining.
All right. Priyanka Yadav. Do I see Priyanka Yadav?
Sir, she's not yet here. I'm trying to contact
All right.
her, but she's not.
Not to worry. Well, Revati, the floor is yours. We are all ears.
Sir, am I audible?
Very much so. You don't want to be visible?
No, sir. I will be sharing my screen.
All right. Go ahead, Revati. When you're ready, tell me, because you will have 5 minutes or 6 minutes in all. But when you're ready, go ahead.
I hope my screen is visible.
Very visible. Go ahead. Your time starts now.
Good morning, everyone. I am today presenting on the topic Elevating New Delhi-Taipei Ties, the Perfect Reply to a Belligerent Dragon. Quickly moving on the wake of the recent developments in the line of the actual control, India is urged to go for a more proactive approach in the region. So there have been serious call on India to reconsider its adherence to Beijing's One China policy. So in 2020, New Delhi and Taipei are celebrating 25 years of their informal partnership. So let us see a brief, very brief analysis of India-Taiwan ties. Starting with the evolution, India was one of the first nations to use the term One China and recognize People's Republic of China as early as in 1949. And later it also supported PRC to replace ROC in membership on UN Security Council in 1971. So the formal ties come to a start in 1995, with Taiwan setting up India Taipei Association. India setting up India Taipei Association in Taipei in 1995, and in response, Taiwan opened up Taipei Economic and Cultural Center in New Delhi a few months later. In 2016, a formal platform for friendship was set up by 22 Indian parliamentarians called the India-Taiwan Parliamentary Friendship Forum. This was a milestone in the relations. And in the same year, very hopefully, Democratic Progressive Party Tsai Ing-wen advent to power. So, quickly moving on. So, an analysis of engagements. Economic relations forms the cornerstones of India-Taiwan ties, with bilateral trade accounting to US dollar $5.7 billion in 2019-20. New Delhi is Taipei's 17th largest trading partner, and both nations have complementary economic structures, with Taiwan being a vital player in hardware manufacturing and India having a wide established software industry. So India's agricultural sector can benefit from Taiwan's well-developed agro-technology and food processing techniques. And very hopefully, last year, the tech giants Wistron and Foxconn plan to invest INR 7,500 crore over 5 years in India. Other areas are academic. And in the last decade, Taiwan established 7 Taipei education centers aimed at training students in Mandarin and classic China. Taiwan hosts 160 accredited universities to accept a considerable number of international students. So India should frame more policies and agreements to divert the inflow of Indian students from China to Taiwan. Intelligence cooperation. Taiwan's intelligence establishment is majorly focused on threat from China. Through an intelligence cooperation, the two countries together can achieve a better coverage of China. Moreover, Taiwan limitations in space program can be solved with a partnership with ISRO. And cultural linkages. In India-Taiwan ties, cultural diplomacy can play a major role. Majority of Taiwan's populations are Buddhist, creating a religious linkages with India. And coming to Taiwan's exemplary gains, which it can present before the world. Both India and Taiwan are Asia's leading democracy and share mutual values of freedom, human rights, and a so strong civil society as a challenge to China. Coming to COVID-19 containing, Taiwan has done a commendable role in containing the COVID-19 outbreak, being just 130 kilometers off from China. Taiwan just had 449 cases with just 7 deaths, that too without a lockdown. Taiwan's developed a technology, rapid response system, and experience in dealing with the SARS in 2003 helped. So, but albeit of these achievements, very unfortunately, Taiwan has still not given a place in World Health Assembly. And coming to gender equality, Taiwan is ranked first in Asia in terms of gender equality and was the first in Asian state to legalize same-sex marriage in 2019. With a female president, 42% of the legislators in parliament are women. There is a progressive development in female workforce with salary gap decreased to just 14%. So all these are exemplary remarks on Taiwan, and it shows how India can learn from a nation which is just 90 times smaller than India.
1 minute.
Okay. And recently we can see Taiwan has extended a hand to India. Yeah, such as Taiwan being one of the very first nations to send medical aid to India and donated over 1 million face masks. And Taiwanese firms are also looking for a safer market to shift their dependence on China in accordance with the US-China trade war. And an increased public support for India can be seen in the following image, which was a very popular with Taiwanese social media. Concluding, India should be very proactive in utilizing the best available opportunity to strengthen its ties with Taiwan. And India should either demand for a proper reciprocal arrangement, like asking China to respect India's One India policy for its adherence to OCP, or else have to reconsider its adherence to One China policy. both Taiwan and India is on mutual trajectory in resisting Chinese aggression, and they should explore the untapped areas of cooperation.
We have to wind up.
Okay, thank you so much.
Bravo. I must say that I have thoroughly enjoyed your presentation. It is impressive that you have covered all the salient aspects of the relationship, touched upon the one China policy, about the fact that this is one country with which we can build economic synergies.
Yes.
Do you think that China will respect one India policy, or does China respect one India policy?
No, sir. Even though India have adhered to one China policy since now, China have never shown its adequate reciprocal arrangement for that. And it has stood against India in the Kashmir issue and in 2010 in Arunachal Pradesh issue in global bodies such as UN. So why should India still wait and adhere to Beijing's one China policy is my question.
Remove the screen. You're sharing the screen. Can you just take it off, please?
Yes, sir. One second. I'm sorry, but I am stuck in between.
try. Because the screen is, I think.
Yeah.
Pakhi, can you do something, or that has to be done at her end?
Oh, one second, sir.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, good. All right. I think this is one relationship which is indeed very important. It's something that we need to be very sensitive about because of the Chinese reaction. China is not a rational power. And they are the designs that they have on practically every country, including Bhutan, is a matter of concern. But yes, you are right that Taiwan has done an amazing job in containing COVID-19, in having the roots of democracy go stronger. Last question to you: do you think we can sign an India-Taipei free trade agreement?
Considering the recent developments, a free trade agreement is too ambitious, I would comment.
Mm-hmm.
In accordance with a belligerent neighbor. Mm-hmm. So both India and Taiwan is under military threat from China right now, and Taiwan and much more. So any such very ambitious, proactive actions might result in, we should be militarily prepared, if not.
So what is the next step we should take in your view?
I still go with strengthening track diplomacy.
All right.
That would be the, yeah.
Got it. Thank you very much, and compliments again. We will come back to that. Come back to your presentation. Is Krupa Varghese there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, go ahead, Krupa.
Yes, sir.
If you can, if you want to use your video, or you will prefer to be in.
I will be sharing the screen.
All right, go ahead, my dear.
Sir, is this visible, the screen?
Yes. Yeah.
So, I'll be starting it now. Good afternoon, everyone. So, my topic is Indo-Pacific pivot in India's geo strategy. So, I'll be covering a few of the aspects or where India is showing its power, and what is Indo-Pacific region all about? We can see that it has been a platform for various civilizational exchanges throughout and from the ancient times. And we can see this platform due attention due to, from Asia Pacific to Indo-Pacific. Why the transition? We ask. But we can say that when we talk about Asia Pacific as such, so it's the Asian countries near to the Pacific region, as to my understanding. So only those countries were included in the whole setup. But when you talk about the Indo-Pacific, it also includes the region or the countries in the Indian Ocean too. So the region has various importance. For example, due to China's, India's and Japan's rising economic power, and due to the region has the nuclear powers in the region like India, China, Pakistan, all these factors are a culminating factor why this region is so important. So basically, we can also put it into four aspects. That's the significance of Indo-Pacific. So when we talk about that, we can say one is the strategic part, which includes the threats. There can be non-traditional threats as well as traditional threats. And the other aspect is China's assertive presence in the Indian Ocean region. So when we talk about the economic aspect of it, we can say the natural resources which the region has and it's getting explored, and also the trade and commerce aspect. As we know that the region has almost 60% of the global trade the region holds. So when we talk about the cooperative initiatives in the region, so we can basically point out few of the initiatives like Quad, Malabar, and Milan Recap, Hub and Spoke, which is put forth by US, Hub and Spoke, where US is the hub and where various other countries like Philippines, Australia, all those are considered to be the spoke countries. And also certain other initiatives are also taken. So when we talk about India's initiative or India's approach to the region, we can divide it into various aspects. Like we can see that India has been providing the region with various surveillance capabilities, like coastal surveillance networks are there. And also we have set up the Information Fusion Center, which provides information from these satellites and to the cordial countries in the region, and to monitor the problems or the piracy or terrorism and all those sorts of things. And we can also see that in 2018, PM Modi has brought up with a term called Sagar, and that is a part of security and growth initiative which India puts forth. And in that speech, we can also witness few points. We can take it as points which India puts forth when it comes to Indo-Pacific. So the importance of partnership and benefit of collaboration, where he says India has to act in an active way in the region and have to leave its isolationism. And the second part is we have to work together in alliances and groupings. And that grouping should not represent a sort of containment towards some countries. And thirdly, we can say that new security architecture in the region, that is free, open, and inclusive Indo-Pacific, that was also one of the aspects. And also the regional architecture for new order, that is India with ASEAN and all those things. So we can see these were the initiatives which India also put forth, and India was also playing a part in the Indo-Pacific. So when we talk about the security dimensions, uh, As I've already said, that there are certain threats which is arising from China's assertive nature and also non-traditional threats. So when we collaborate all these and when we have an cooperative approach towards the whole region, we can surely say that it can be an advent of influential powers, and we can say that this region can come up with the utopian concept of can really contribute to the term Asian century. And when we talk about the ocean of opportunity,
you have 10 seconds to wind up, my dear.
Okay, sir. So when we talk about the ocean of opportunities, we can see that if it's successful, we can be when its cooperative mechanisms are successful, we can be economically prosper, and also we can come up with the Asian century aspect altogether. So this is just a quote from PM Narendra Modi regarding the Indo-Pacific region.
All right. I will request you to wind up, please.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank
you very much. You have been very understanding. Compliments. I must commend you for taking up a topic which is extremely important for not only us, but for the democratic world, for the region as a whole. Now, when you say that it is the Indo-Pacific concept is not directed against any country or to contain any country, but if that particular country or countries are in the business of containing the others, then do you think that that's a fair thing to do?
Yes, sir. Sir, I feel that if the strategy or say the term containment, and it should not be a threat to other countries, but if other countries are trying to do that, then I think that we can also took an alternative to the approach, and we can revisit the statement because we can see that the region is a platform of or we can say the dynamics of change and continuation persist in the region. So I feel that if a certain sort of threat is there because of this statement, then we have to take an alternative measure to it.
Very true. I mean, we have to take note of the fact that there is no agreed definition still amongst major actors on what constitutes the Indo-Pacific region, right? Major actors have different understandings or outlook towards the Indo-Pacific region. Can you give the participants a perspective on what's the outlook of India and US, for example?
Yes, sir. So regarding the regional cooperation?
No, when it comes to the geographical spread of the Indo-Pacific region, do you think India and the US have a similar outlook, or we have a different outlook?
So when it comes to the Indo-Pacific region, I feel that US wants the region to have a balanced approach and not a sort of rivalry or competition. It's not. It says that it wants to see it as a to balance the powers in the region. But when it comes to India, India is also aiming the same, I feel, because India, it's not just containment, as I have already said, it's not just containing a particular country or say China, but India's approach is a little different. But in a way, we can say that US also has this confronting nature towards China's rising power also in the region.
Yeah, so, make it, you know, you may want to see a study, the comparative outlook of key players, let's say India, US, Japan, the ASEAN countries, etc., of what is their definition of the Indo-Pacific region. For us, it's the widest. For us, it is the Indian Ocean countries are very much a part of the Indo-Pacific region. And we talk of the Indo-Pacific region as spreading as a spread from eastern shores of Africa to the western shores of the US, of US, the American continent, right? But for USA, it's more like in Asia-Pacific minus China plus India. So, and it's evolving. And it is evolving because of particularly one power, which is wanting to, you mentioned the Asian century. I would like you and other scholars also to see whether we are now heading for an Asian century or there is a power challenging the Asian century concept and wanting to usher in a Chinese century. Because I was posted in China in the first decade of this century when they used to call India and China as the two growth engines of Asia. That lingo is gone. So it's a very interesting topic. It's a topic which will continue to gain salience in the coming years. So compliments, my dear, for taking it up and giving it very good treatment. We'll come back to the discussion. Parvi, are you ready?
Yes, sir. I'm ready.
Go ahead, my dear.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Chair. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible and you have all of 5 minutes.
Okay. Thank you. So my presentation here is going to deal with the HR perspective and the rules and regulations that we have talked about. So firstly, without going too much detail, so I would like to tell a few more examples as China implemented. So India can be put through the same channel, like extension and suspension of business operations, whereas this national level of circular was supplemented subsequently by the various regulations on provincial level, of all of which being subject to continued changes and therefore requiring close attention to both employers and employees. The provincial level, when we talk about China provincial level regulations, it differ in terms of scope from another to another, reflecting the extent of impact of the COVID-19 on the respective provinces, depending on the specific scopes. Companies shall arrange the future suspension of business operation production, provide the required work arrangement. So there are some rules which need to be regulated and on the basis of the HR rule and HR policies, like remuneration, where China and I think most of the companies, they deduct their salary for if you are in the LWP and if you are in the absence. But I think that is very ill treatment towards the employees, because if someone goes to for treatment, they are counted as a LWP, but it should not be done. And another point, the salary shall be paid during the period that the employee is absent from work in order to receive medical treatment, as I said, medical observation, or who is subject to quarantine or any other emergency measures taken by the government. But besides this, there are few more things like flexible work arrangement and work protection. Notice from HRRS provides that all the MNCs and corporate houses with certain flexibility in light of COVID-19 to further arrange their business operations productions after the suspension of thereof due to the governmental policies. In case companies experiences difficulties in upholding their business operation production, such companies may adjust their employees' salaries and time shift in order to avoid a worst case scenario of mass layoff. Such adjustment required the prior consultation with employees. However, the HRSS notice does not specify the consultation procedure. It is therefore recommended to obtain the consent of all the employees or align with the trade union, if any. Companies that do not require on production site or specific equipment to carry out their business operations may also consider offering employees home office solutions. That is using their online meeting software, online collaborative editing software, etc. During home office period, employees shall receive the salary as agreed in their respective labor contract. Employers in PRC have general obligations to provide employees with a safe and healthy work environment in light of the COVID-19. Companies shall provide their employees sanitation protection against the COVID-19 virus, including no, but not limited to regular disinfection of the office, monitoring and registration of non-staff visitors, etc. According to a present conference of the State Council in response to the COVID-19 epidemic held on 11th of February 2020, companies shall also provide employees with respiratory masks upon the return of the workplace. Central government have further issued a detailed action plan which need to be incorporated. And at the same time, employees' failure to comply with such governmental action plans may lead to administrative penalties as provided by the implementing measures of the PRC law. That has to be revert back, because I don't think this is very justice with the employees. That's a very short presentation.
All right. Now, if I see from your title, you were supposed to speak about patience and time as, isn't it?
Yes.
As the two.
Patience, why I'm talking about patience and time. Firstly, I would like to tell this, I took from Tolstoy. But when you talk about patience, because companies,
switch off your video.
Yeah.
Switch off your video, then okay. The audio will become better. Now go ahead, please.
Okay. Firstly, I would like to say, sir, this is a quotation from Leo Tolstoy. And then powerful warriors, because patience and time. Companies are basically bound to do their work. And if there are some delays in work, there should be some prior notice on the employee. So that's why I noted it is just patience. So companies must have their own patient key. If there is a timeline, so might be you have to compromise your timeline, since people are working from their home and the connectivity, all along connectivities are not at ease and everywhere. So you have to be very patient. And time, why I'm talking about time, because once we have to be tolerant with the time, that's all.
What do you mean being tolerant with the time?
Tolerant with the time, that means we have to we have to safeguard ourselves, at the same time be ready for the situation.
Yeah. Now, when you say patient, if I understood you right, you are trying to say that if there's a corporate house, it has got employees, there is a difficult situation, so the management should be patient. Is that your argument?
Yes, sir. Management should have patience.
Now, my question yes, to you is that you are the CEO of, let us say, a medium-sized company. There are 20 people you have employed. There is COVID-19. Your work has come to a standstill. And your monthly bill of salaries is 4 lakh rupees.
Yeah.
How many months will you keep on paying them?
But I think there should be a timeline, but timeline is flexible. Suppose if you have to do this next day, that means it can be delayed. That means not before the day ends. The half day, that means the first half I can tolerate with, but not after that.
All right. Very good point. Thank you. Okay. Who is the next speaker now? Who is the next speaker? Pakhi, is anybody?
So Ms. Priyanka has joined us now. So can we have her as the next speaker?
Should we allow Priyanka or tell her that she cannot speak? We penalize her. What do you say?
Hello, can you hear me?
No, no, sir, please.
Yes, Priyanka, we can hear you. Go ahead.
I'm really sorry that I'm joining late.
You're not
so. So I would like to start my presentation. First of all, good afternoon, everyone, honorable chairperson, and everyone present around here. And first of all, I would like to thank you for providing me with this wonderful opportunity. So today I'm going to talk about bilateral context of a multilateral strategic initiative, India-South Korea in the emerging Indo-Pacific strategic power play. So first of all, my point of discussion would be about India and South Korea, but in the emerging and evolving Indo-Pacific construct. But when I'm discussing India and South Korea, my point about is about in the light of aggressive rise of China and why India and South countries like India and South Korea should align themselves in the Indo-Pacific region. With China's increasing assertiveness in the South China Sea and Indo-Pacific, nations like India and South Korea recently have seemed to gain common ground in their foreign policy agenda to counter the hegemonic design of China. In this context, when we talk about India and South Korea, both the countries aims to be aspiring power in the region. And both the countries have been recently at the receiving, like India recently have been at the receiving end of the China's increasing assertiveness. China has been using its economic, its various tools like either militarily or using its economic tools like trade or loans to force various countries, like including apart from India and South Korea and other ASEAN countries as well. And in this, in the face of common threat, India and South Korea relationship becomes an important part of the larger Indo-Pacific strategy led by US to counter the China and to secure a rule-based order in the region. While Korea being a traditional ally to the US in the region, better sees its interest aligned with democratic US in checking the hostile rise of China. When we talk about India and South Korea, it becomes very significant to discuss that both countries share democratic values, promoting a free market economy, and now signaling towards a commitment to promote a free, inclusive, rule-based Indo-Pacific order. On bilateral level, various countries have started various foreign policy initiatives. Like Korea's new southern policy aimed at scaling ties with the ASEAN members and India, while India also sees South Korea as an indispensable partner in its Act East strategy. And expanding stronger relations between India and South Korea in the ASEAN-centric regional architecture can be the main basis of cooperation to build their strategic shared narrative of Indo-Pacific in the region. And India and South Korea has also started their various synergizing initiatives and to build cultural connect like Korea Plus, and also Korea is keen to invest in the manufacturing sector through programs of Make in India. However, while India pursuing prudent foreign policy, India prefers the idea of strategic autonomy for the Indo-Pacific region rather than being a pivot of US strategy to Indo-Pacific. And South Korea can be aligned on the same lines because South Korea is also very hesitant in openly embracing Indo-Pacific since it has to tread carefully in the US and China-led environment. So one thing is common, we can say one thing that both India and South Korea till now have been adhering to the Chinese risk aversion strategy. However, in response to the Quad and the recent proposal of the US that they want to militarize the Quad, and the region becomes very important, and there are probable prospects of the region that the idea of militarizing the region in reality can be considered soon. But till now, the idea is still evolving, and both in the nations like India and South Korea are very about they want to play the game very strategically, and they don't want to come out in the open and claim the region in military sense. So
45 seconds.
Yeah, sorry. So both India and South Korea both are vibrant nations, and both wants to aim for balance of power of the region and with the respect of international laws, and freedom of navigation. I guess both India and South Korea should discuss more probable measures and strategies to counter the assertive rise of China. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You have touched upon certain vital aspects of the relationship. It so happens that I was India's ambassador to South Korea for more than 3 years till 2015. And
yes, sir, I'm aware of that.
So there are certain bits that I would like to mention to you. You are right, although you noted it later in your presentation, that Korea is very sensitive about Chinese concerns. And, you know, because they owe a debt of cultural gratitude. And China has become Korea's largest trading partner.
Right.
What you need to appreciate is that there is a very strong political divide in Korea among the conservatives and the liberals or the Democrats. When there's a conservative government, they tilt towards the US. When there is a liberal government or a Democratic government, they tilt towards China.
China
has been very tough on South Korea. Did you read about the THAAD missiles?
Yes, sir. Yes, sure.
When in 2015 they brought in two batteries or three batteries of THAAD missiles, there were huge economic sanctions against South Korea. So I'm very amused now when the Chinese diplomats and politicians say with a straight face that politics and economic matters should not go hand in hand. I mean, they say it in, but China is the first country always to use economic measures. Secondly, did you say that USA is trying to militarize Quad?
Sir, my point is that recently Trump administration has been very vocal about Indo-Pacific in comparison to the previous administrations of US, and they want to militarize the region, or they want to project their power in the region, because recently in US also they have been conducting joint naval exercises in the region near the South China Sea. So they want to counter China by militarizing South China Sea and Indo-Pacific.
No, Priyanka, you may want to study it a little more. South China Sea is not being militarized by the US. It is being militarized by China. Mm-hmm. And the unfortunate thing is that the Obama administration looked the other way while China was militarizing the South China Sea. And now it is perhaps a bit too late, but the US is now putting China on notice. So no, the USA is not trying to militarize South China Sea, and nor do I get a sense that they are trying to militarize Quad, but there is a basic security gap. The question is that the security architecture in the Asian region, Asian continent, has been affected since the US has started looking inward. So American commitment to the security guarantees for the Asian region or Asian continent is no longer certain. And then you have a belligerent and expansionist power. So everybody is concerned about the security. And it is bound to happen that sooner than later or later, a new security architecture will emerge. All right. Pakhi, anybody else?
No, sir, I haven't received any notification as of.
Okay, good. So we have a bunch of questions. Let us take those questions first, and then we will get into an internal discussion. Let us take the questions first. All right. Okay. All right, to Shivani. Okay, there is a question for Shivani from Shivaram. Shivani, can you see this question?
Yes, sir. I've already answered the question in the chat box, but if you would like me to...
Yes, we would. Let me just see this question. India stated no first use policy changing, as Defense Minister earlier said, India might revise it. Yeah, go ahead, please. Very good question. Yeah.
Right. So, as I've mentioned, such statements have come into light, and they are a cause of concern, because when I talk about nuclear culture, a lot of it also has to do with the kind of public rhetoric that we see around thinking around nuclear weapons in any state for that matter. So such statements are definitely crucial, but at the same time, if we look at Mr. Parker's statement, it was in his personal capacity, as he also mentioned. And as far as other statements from other generals is concerned, I see that more as a recommendation that India should be advancing or revising its posture, but that is no indication of whether such a change has already happened or whether such a change is even being deliberated in the strategic circles. So it would be too far of a stretch to say that any definitive change has happened or is happening. And as far as this gentleman mentioned the Uri attacks, so one can see, especially under the Modi dispensation, one can see an increasing calibrated use of force in the conventional realm. But whether that is a clear indicator of any such change happening or any such use of force options being undertaken in the nuclear realm is, again, too far a stretch. So change is definitely happening, but whether that change will percolate into the nuclear domain or not, we can't say, because nuclear culture is something that has to be assessed and analyzed over years and decades. So it's not like crisis points are important, but it's not, it takes a lot longer than that, because it's a gradual change, a gradual shift.
Appreciate it. Fellow panelists, any of you wants to comment on this very vital question? Anybody amongst the panelists, whether India's nuclear posture is changing? No? All right. Just one brief comment. Anybody? No? Okay. One brief comment, Shiva, from my side. One thing that India is very proud of is credibility. We have in our history, as far as we can make out, never made a commitment, international commitment, signed an agreement, financial commitment that we have broken. Because it comes to haunt you. And if there's a change of, so we have made a solemn commitment about no first use, one. Two, the entire posture has to change, because right now we have the posture of a credible minimum deterrent, and based on a triad, and we have limited number of nuclear warheads. You can check. I have no inside information. I'm not revealing any national secret to you. So but if you are going to do away with no first use, you have to qualitatively expand your arsenal. The entire posture has to change, and the entire basis of on which we had the 1-2-3 agreement or the 2008 agreement of NSG waiver comes to a nod. The problem basically is that we have one of our neighbors which at the drop of the hat would hint at using tactical weapons. If India sneezes, they would hint at using tactical weapons. If there was action against terrorists, they would do that. So I guess some things were said, but saying something off the cuff, even at a senior level, and changing the national policy are two different things. So my limited understanding is that there is no change in the policy of no first use, but certainly we are not going to compromise our security. So what Shivani is referring to, I would partly agree with her, partly not, because use of conventional weapons we will have to do if we are attacked or there is a threat to India's security. All right. Now, is there any other question? Ayush, when it comes to India's vision of All right. There's a question on the Indo-Pacific region. Would you like to take it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Krupa, go ahead.
Sir, so I feel that U.S. influence or U.S. Attention is also onto the Pacific and especially South China Sea also. But I don't find a new type of different approach towards the whole situation, even if there, if Joe Biden wins the election. American election this time, but I feel that we have yet to see what will be the approach towards such situations, and especially when China is continuing its strategies in the South China Sea, like building islands and all those things. So I don't feel that until and unless otherwise, China should have an approach of not building means islands in the South China Sea, and US have different stands on it. I don't think that both the presidency, if there is a shift in the presidency, it will affect much, because they both will have an equal approach to China, and that is to contain it. US will definitely have this approach, I guess. I don't think it's a shift.
Anybody has any panelists? Anybody has another comment on this subject? All right. Is there any other question before we start getting to an internal discussion? No? All right. I have a question essentially for Shivani. Swasti, and then we can open up to the others also. Swasti, two questions. You know, G20 summit process, I've been very fortunate to have attended the first five G20 summits, starting in Washington, and I think the fifth one was in Cannes, if I remember. And the 2008-2000 London summit, the second summit, if you remember, in 2009, was the most effective in terms of coming up with the solutions to the subprime crisis. Now, one, do you think the G20 has lost its steam and effectiveness? One. Two, President Trump had recently mooted the idea of a G11, so to say. And I don't know whether it has faced opposition from the G7 countries. There is lots of ifs and buts. But do you think that G20 is unwieldy and G11 is the solution? Two questions, please.
Thank you, sir. Okay, the first question first, as to whether G20 has lost its sheen and whether G11 should come up. I personally feel that multilateralism, again, looking at it from a very constructivist approach, should be able to solve the most pressing matter of the day. Okay, so if the G20 is unable, I think the approach should be to not be stuck at a particular sort of, say, grouping, and to constantly, constantly engage with the idea of reinterpreting it. Okay, so to say that the G11 is going to come and solve every problem.
If it's not, you said, engage with the idea of?
Of that continuous change, that if the G20 is not being able to solve the problem, there should not be so much fixation, within the world community to still carry on with the very fact that we have a G5 and a G7, G8, G20, G77 is because we are pretty much aware of the fact that, if we don't need to come to an impasse. But as to say that G11 is going to solve the problems, I don't know. I'm not sure. Time can tell. G20 has its, logic intact. Because it catered very well in the post 2007 financial crisis. It is a fairly flexible platform, and then India, I think, because it is the first time that India is going to be the president, that itself is an opportunity, and As to how India will deliver on it, I told you, you know, there are certain problems. To my mind, the biggest are the economic problems. And that brings me to the next question that you pointed out, you know, when I was presenting, which was about that, is the Indian economy ready for it? Okay, and what should the Indian economy do? Precisely, I would be talking about only 3 points, you know, with respect to this. Definitely, the Indian economy isn't all drums. And I think only last week, IMF chief said that among the G20 countries, India has shrunk the most. So obviously, a lot of bad news coming in from all quarters. However, I think if you talk about what needs to be done, obviously, we need another stimulus package, but then how do we go about it? You know, what do we do? 3 points from my understanding. The first thing is, you know, we need structural reforms, okay, within the economy. And when I say structural reforms, I particularly mean...
I've lost all my hair listening to structural reforms.
Yeah, so as for structural reforms, yeah, so... we need labor reforms. We need them. We need them to be more flexible. A lot of you know, academics and a lot of analysts are talking about that. We need to free agricultural. We need to free the agricultural sector. You know, so many farmers and all that disbalance is there. There's hardly any time for me to get into the length and breadth of it. And I think the third and the most important thing that I would like to say as an international you know, analyst is that, you know, India has to come out of this. Very irrational protectionism, you know, around its approach about RCEP, because RCEP is key. I personally feel that India is right now in a very good position to negotiate favorable terms at the RCEP. You know, all of the India, the Quad allies, etc., everybody's in the RCEP. Japan, particularly Abe, was very disappointed with the decision of India to not join the RCEP. I think India is really missing out on that global supply chain. How else do you revive an economy? What do you do? If you take more packages, if you take more lending, it is going to, you know, bring inflation. And how do you control that? So you need to kind of get into the demand global supply chains. And RCEP is such a wonderful thing. And right now, particularly, because I understand India's tensions about it, that Indian economy not being ready, etc. But I think India is in a position to negotiate some favorable terms. To write it off as something which is, I personally feel is going to be very catastrophic in current circumstances. Those are my bit.
I'll comment on that. Panelists, any participants, any comment on G20 Indian economy? Come on, guys. All right. You know, Swasti, we have a couple of issues, serious issues. I have sat in the free trade agreement negotiations with Korea and Canada. We are basically very scared of competition. And our industry in particular is so used to being in a licensed raj in a controlled environment. You know, I was posted in New York when we had the 1991 reforms. And you may have heard or read about the Bombay Club in 1991, you know, comprising of stalwarts like Mr. Bajaj and others who were vehemently opposed to reforms. Even in 1991, when we were a basket case, our foreign exchange reserves had come down to $2 billion, gold was pawned. So we are actually scared of competition, whatever we say. And RCEP also, I am with you, although I am in a minority view in amongst the former or present civil servants. The point is, we negotiated RCEP for so many months. And at the last minute, then we came up with further concerns. All right, if there are concerns, moot them.
True, agreed.
But how can you be a part of the global supply chain if you don't become competitive, if you do not have... the economies of scale, we have to scale up. India is one country where there are barriers in terms of scaling up. And the higher you go, the more difficult it becomes. So, I mean, and the factor reforms that you're talking of is something that we need not today, not tomorrow, but yesterday. I mean, labor reforms, land reforms. So I don't know when it will happen. Now, we have done a tremendous thing in terms of improving the ease of doing business from 141 to 62 or 63. But my contention is that even now, 62 countries are ahead of you.
True.
When there's an investment dollar, you know, just because we speak English, it's not going to come to us. I mean, there are 62 other countries. So, I mean, we have concerns. But
if you can give me 20 seconds, I mean, I'm just going to add to what you were saying, and you may be taking note of it. You know, Abenomics, Shinzo Abe's policies, economic policies in Japan, and, you know, he came up with so much fanfare, and they were basically about 3 points. And initially in the first in his first term, they started to deliver also, but because there weren't the necessary structural reforms in place, it fell flat. And eventually then, you know, COVID pandemic hit and all that. So I think we have a lot of precedent outside in the world to see that even if there was a robust economy, it would still not be able to, you know, sustain without the necessary structural reforms. And I personally then feel extremely disturbed about the self-reliant rhetoric, you know, in India, that without the necessary competitiveness and without the necessary structural reforms, I mean, where are we trying to hide behind? I mean, as an analyst. So I'm totally with you on that. Thank you for your patience, sir.
In fact, the three arrows of he wanted the investments, the same investments in the railways, infrastructure, et cetera, et cetera. But nobody wants to bite the bullet. The consumer tax, they could not impose. Yes. When they imposed, there was a huge, I mean, there are challenges everywhere. True. But let's see. I mean, I hope that we are in a position to leverage our big market. All right.
Thank you.
Anybody, any other question? Okay. Last question as far as I am concerned. Krupa, Revati, you were talking about the IPR, right? Indo-Pacific region, or Krupa?
It's Krupa.
The Indo-Pacific region I was talking about, yeah. India's geostrategy.
I didn't have my notes in front of me. Yeah. Now, Russia, what do you see Russia's position on the Indo-Pacific region?
When Russia is concerned, I feel that Russia is not actually being a very significant player in all the initiatives and all. I don't know why they have been so silent in all those things, but I have not find much of Russia's, projection in the Indo-Pacific region much too. Maybe during the Cold War, they might have the, you know, the intrusion, or say the conflict situation was there with the US. So definitely during that time, they were prevalent, I guess, but not presently. I don't see Russia much influencing much extensive power in the region.
Look at that, since you are following the Indo-Pacific region, look at India's position towards Russia. We are very keen to get Russia agree because it's not that there is some kind of a central forum or authority which will stamp its approval and say, well, this is the Indo-Pacific region. As you mentioned, this is different countries have a different outlook. But for us, strategically, to get Russia on board is important. I mean, certainly US does not want, in their scheme of things, Russia is not a part of the Indo-Pacific region. All right?
Yes, sir.
Final few minutes, if anybody, panelists, anybody has a comment, observation, the floor is open.
So if I may just add to the Russian influence in the Indo-Pacific, I think we are entering a very interesting space because this entire, the 5-point declaration has been kind of mediated by Russia. So one thing is for sure is that Russia does not want too much trouble in the Indo-Pacific.
Wait.
Yes, yes.
How did you say that by Russia?
Not really, because it happened in Moscow at the Shanghai Cooperation Organization meeting. I think it's Russia played at least the good boy there, you know, as in trying to bring the enemies together to a table. But I think a lot of analysts would say that they were expecting something out of it. And the 5-point declaration isn't a guarantee. It nowhere looks like a guarantee, but it is important in its own way. Following what has been happening at the LSE. So the point that I wanted to make was that Russia does not want too much trouble, you know, in the Indo-Pacific, and would probably benefit. Though again, Russia is, since the world is continuously obsessed with China, we kind of a lot of times forget that the Russians also have a very strong anti-US or anti-US hegemonic approach. So we will see, but it is interesting that they would want some rules-based order there. They would not want too much disturbance, not the kind of disturbance that is happening, you know, between India and China. So I think that is my assessment of it. Yeah, thank you.
All right, thank you. Shivani, any last minute? Anything that you need to add, comment?
Just on the point that you made, sir, regarding your feedback. So I was obviously not able to maybe explain better, but when I was referring to the 47 to 98 period, pre-1998 period, I did not mean to undermine the importance of the external security threat perceptions that obviously, that played a very important role in shaping India's nuclear thinking and a nuclear culture around this particular class of weapons. But at least in my reading of it, if you had to take the 5 influencing factors and rank it in order of preference and priority, time and again, in this particular period, the economic considerations have ranked have always ranked high in India's nuclear decision making, and obviously there are a lot of statements and historical speeches, etc., to which point towards this particular aspect. But yeah, I mean, security considerations definitely were a driver for the kind of nuclear trajectory that we've seen in case of India. But at least in my opinion, if you had to rank it, economic considerations definitely took precedence over any other, which is why I say that the nuclear culture has been primarily accommodative in that sense and not extremely outrightly defensive or offensive for that particular time period.
Well, Shivani, I respect your right to have, as a British say, we may agree to disagree. But, you know, I understand where you're coming from. My understanding, and it's a perspective, unfortunately, no Prime Minister of India consulted me on the nuclear posture, so I cannot claim any inside information. But, you know, my take is that when there was a lot of political pressure on India, lot of political pressure, especially after 1974. Please do remember that we were the first country in Asia to have a civil nuclear reactor. First country, even before Japan or any country. And we had the technology even in the late 50s, early 60s. Mm-hmm. When China went nuclear in 64, we could have gone nuclear. So, but A, our policy of not having a nuclear world with every country getting armed with nuclear weapons. We believe genuinely or other whatever, politically, that was not conducive to India's interest and the global interest. But after CTBT, we were very keen to go nuclear. But then there was so much of pressure, political pressure on India from the world powers, that Indian leaders found it difficult to thwart that or disregard that. So it was not so much economic in my view, but it was political. And the push factor was security. Because China became nuclear in 64. Pakistan's nuclear device was tested by China in 89 or 90 or something in Lopnor. In Indian Ocean, you had nuclear weapons going back and forth. So we were quite vulnerable at that period. So, and when it comes to national security, you're normally not bothered about too much about economic considerations, but you needed, and by the way, again, going by published material, Prime Minister Narasimha Rao was quite close at one point of time of going nuclear, but the Americans got to know of it, and they applied pressure. So, but in 98, the government did it, and you know how they did it. They camouflaged it, and there was a huge uproar, economic downside, but we kind of managed to ride it. So what I'm trying to say is that the economic aspect is slightly overstated. And it is very convenient at times, when you want to deflect pressure, instead of saying that there's political pressure, external pressure, you say, there are economic considerations. So there is a little bit of posturing involved. But this is, as I said, just my take. All right. You are very welcome to, this is an important subject. So, we can agree or disagree till cows come home. But I'm happy that, you have been following the subject for a while?
Quite a while, sir. So I did my MPhil from JNU itself. So it was precisely, I think, two, three years back.
Good. Good.
But all points taken, sir. It's an interesting topic. So, yeah.
Very interesting topic. And this is one of the success stories of India's foreign policy and internal policy, because 98 in my book was a game changer. Definitely. So that is how I see it. All right. Since there are no other questions, first, what is left for me to thank you all for the excellent presentations that you made. Some of you were provocative, which has to be so. All of you were substantive. And some of my young colleagues and friends who are in college, taking up such difficult subjects, doing justice to it, is something which is admirable. I, believe me or not, once I was also in college and of your age, I could not have thought of coming up with such presentations. So God bless you all. Keep up what you're doing. And Paki, can we wind up? Are we done?
It's absolutely up to you.
Well, we are done. I'm done. If anybody has a question or comment, I'm still open. Question, comment, criticism, dart, missile, bank, bouquet, anything. None. Okay, Paki, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thank you, all the speakers. Distinguished Chair, ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of the 12th session. It's my honor to propose a word of thanks on behalf of NICE to all those who have graced us with their presence and contributed their parts to make this event a resounding success. First of all, we would like to express our gratitude and sincere thanks to Ambassador Vishnu Prakash for agreeing to chair the session today. Our sincere thanks also goes to all our speakers for being a part of the event and delivering such comprehensive and convincing presentations in such a short period of time provided to them. We are really honored to have you all with us today. We would like to acknowledge our gratitude to all our friends from the diplomatic community, experts, academia, media, and different organizations. Finally, I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for our audience who participated in the webinar and those who are watching us live on our YouTube channel. Thank you for your valuable time and attention and for making the session productive with your questions. We're truly blessed to have you all with us this morning, and we hope to stay connected with you in future as well. It's really been a pleasure. Also, do join us in the next session. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.